Hi, I'm Bob Beliles, and today, along with my co-presenter, Ray Coulombe, we're going to discuss, does physical security on the network create new vulnerabilities? I'm going to go ahead and lead the discussion, and I'm going to come at this from a top-down perspective in terms of how physical security and network security can work together and what those vulnerabilities are. The first thing to recognize is that physical security has long been siloed off from most other systems. In fact, they've even been running on analog systems. But over the last 4 or 5 years, you've seen an increase in the number of vendors offering network-connected physical security systems, both in terms of physical access control, as well as in CCTV or video surveillance type applications. The real problem here, though, is that even though now physical security systems are sharing the same infrastructure, the IP networks, that most other business applications run on, and of course IT security supports, the challenge is that there's really no sharing of information between these two different systems, and as a result of that, you have organizations have no holistic way to look at security breaches and address compliance issues that really affect both sides, IT security as well as physical security. Some of the examples there to consider is think about the fact that there's no consistent way to handle user or system provisioning. So in fact, what you typically have is, in a siloed organization, user provisioning and rights for physical facility access is completely separate from those rights and privileges that they might have on the network side. Of course, when you deprovision a user, you have to take them out of two or even potentially three systems, including the HR system. Also consider the fact that relative to these other gaps that we have in not having converged security today, think about the fact that there's no way to have a good consolidation of the activity reports for a particular individual or a series of events that occur on the physical side as well as on the network side. So if someone's behavior starts to change, they start going into rooms or buildings that they don't typically go into, and suddenly they start accessing different network resources that they typically didn't, and it wasn't a result of a change in their role in the organization, that might be an indicator that there's a problem there. Now, this problem is becoming recognized amongst those in the C-suite. A survey of 50 global $1 billion to $100 billion corporate CIOs, CSOs, and CISOs concluded a number of things. And number one, they recognized that there did need to be, and that they did need to have some formal mechanism for coordination between IT security as well as physical security. But one of the most startling facts here was that 73% of those surveyed believe that a vulnerability in one system or the other can lead to a breach in the one that wasn't originally vulnerable. So the key thing to think about here is that we have visibility and an opportunity to address this problem. And in terms of addressing that problem, we need to consider the fact that content, applications, infrastructure, individuals, devices, all need to be able to be secure, and they all need to be trusted devices. And of course, there's a lot of conversation on that today in terms of trust and identity and the rights and privileges. We need to start to have those for all devices and to protect the data when it's at rest, as well as while it's being transmitted. In terms of physical security, we are starting to see some movement such that these systems, as they come onto the network, do have to apply or address certain standards. Among those, from the common credential or the smart card credentials, their smart capability, microprocessors are on those cards today. They can handle cryptographic functions. They can securely store biometric templates, as well as even be part of a certificate checking in order to have that trust and responsibility and the rights associated with it for a strong level of authentication. There are a number of federal government identity initiatives out there, most notably HSPD 12, as well as a number of other federal initiatives for first responders and emergencies, transportation worker identity cards. All of these kinds of cards are in systems are requiring higher levels of security and in closing those problems that you might have or those loops that you might have in terms of or gaps that you might have in terms of having physical security creating new vulnerability. So they're actually holding the physical security systems that are on the networks to the same level of standards for security that any other IT-oriented application or system requires as well. The Federal Information Security Management Act, you may be very familiar with from an IT perspective, that along with a CIA directive, these are all aimed at basically making sure that every single device that's connected to the network, including physical security systems, have the right level of security, that have the right levels of trust associated with them, that the processes in terms of how these systems and the individuals are enrolled on them. There are a number of different steps there to make sure that, that these devices are secure, and they also behave well so that they don't create problems for other devices that are on this shared common infrastructure. The Trusted Computing Group is also approaching the physical security world and highlighting some of the opportunities that they have to be able, relative to the architectures and standards, how those can apply to physical security systems as well, and we're starting to see some adoption there. The physical security industry itself has a number of different industry initiatives. Some of those are on the video surveillance side, being driven by some vendors. There are a couple of different initiatives, so we're starting to see additional, or at least proposals, to actually standardize on the way we do things, and a lot of that has to deal with network security. Finally, there are UL standards in terms of how these systems are managed, monitored, how the information is handled, that have long been out there in the physical security world that vendors for these systems have to support. Real quick snapshot here. My particular company has gone through and works with a number of federal agencies. They all have certification and accreditation tests. And again, this is all kind of under the auspices of FISMA and some of these other standards we've talked about. I'm not going to go into detail here. This is really just a sampling of the kinds of things that these audits are performed on different physical security vendors' systems to make sure that they are secure and trusted. A little bit more in terms of thought and in terms of the context here. We talk a lot about identities today, both on the IT side as well as on the physical security side. You know, the converged identity makes an awful lot of sense. You can have multi-factor authentication on them. There are a number of processes and standards, again, that we've already kind of talked about that are there. One interesting fact in terms of are these processes and standards, are they having an impact? The answer is yeah. Great study here using the DoD. They had a significant reduction in fraud, you can see here in terms of the numbers, once they went to this common credential that could be used both to access a building as well as access a device, a PC, as well as the network behind that PC. And ultimately, in closing that loop, you've also got to have not just a common credential, it's that common infrastructure. So every single device, again, on the network has to be trusted, authenticated. You can see here how that plays in. With this next slide, what I really wanted to highlight is an opportunity to actually enhance physical security as well as network security by tying two systems together here. In this particular case, what I'm trying to show is that we are solving the problem by essentially saying that you cannot log on to the network until you have badged into the building. The problem that we're solving here is that employee tailgating, the fact that someone walks in behind someone else, doesn't use their credential at the door to actually log them in this case is going to result in the employee not getting access to the network. No information from the physical security system in terms of his presence in the building has been communicated, in this case, to a metadata server that ultimately communicates with a NAC appliance, network access control appliance. So since the NAC policies have now been updated to include the physical presence of an individual being in a building, what it says is they're outside of the building, so therefore they cannot have access to those network resources from inside the building. So the network now believes that the employee is not in the building. So what happens? Well, the employee's got to go back to the front door. They go ahead and properly badge in. Of course, the door opens for them. That information is communicated to the physical security server here that's off on the upper right-hand corner. That information then conveys that, in this case, the person has indeed logged in or is now known to be inside the building. Once they get to their office and request network access, in this particular case, the network access control server, with that policy in terms of only granting network access when they're inside the building, they're going to go ahead and basically say, great, you're in the building, your username and your password match, your health of your device matches, So you're good to go. We're going to go ahead and allow you to be admitted to the network and enjoy the rights and privileges associated with your policies there. The result on this is it doesn't just solve a physical security problem. We can start to think about the little yellow sticky problem relative to accessing PCs. Even if I have my username and my password written down, and you come into a building and I'm not there, and as long as I've told the physical security system that I'm out of the building, even with my PC, the correct username and password, if someone tries to log in with that information while I'm outside of the building, but they're inside the building, they're going to be denied access to those network resources. So you can see here that it's very complementary. The beauty of all this is that it does give you a single point of control for all of your security information when you tie these two systems together. You can have a single identity that runs across the entire enterprise. So basically, if I delete a user from the physical security system, they will also be deleted out of, or their access rights will be revoked in terms of their access to networked resources. You can start to have correlation of activity reports, solving some of those gaps that I talked about a few minutes ago. And you can also have life cycle user provisioning, where based on their roles throughout the thing, you can grant dynamically start to add or take away rights and privileges relative to what they may be doing in a particular environment. Also great in terms of enabling, disabling contractors, and you can start to think about the concepts of federation here as well. In terms of kind of summing things up, is physical security creating new vulnerabilities for the network? I'd point out that a siloed system is pretty good in terms of being able to do certain things, but of course, without the ability to share that information, you have those gaps that we've kind of talked about. You miss out on the benefits in terms of actually now making both physical security and IT security more secure because you're not sharing that information between the two systems. And then we can kind of start to go back and add into this. You can start to see how as we add more and more capabilities, if you're looking for a physical security system that has these additional capabilities, your security posture on both the IT side and the physical security side is going to improve and grow over time. Closing things up, yes, there are a number of issues and opportunity. Corporate CISOs, CSOs see these issues and challenges. We have an opportunity to make things better. There is the security and the trust of particular physical security devices, in my opinion, does vary greatly. Ray's going to talk a little bit more about that in detail. So it is very much of a you've got to look at each specific vendor to see what they're capable of doing. Standards are going to make things better, but clearly the ability to share information between these two systems is going to enhance security as well as compliance for an organization. And likewise, you're going to start to see you're adding value as these two worlds work together, and you can also do it in such a way that basically you're avoiding the politics in terms of how you pass the information back and forth. It's still up to the physical security guys to make a decision on what's going on when they see an event from the network side, and conversely, the network security guys are going to make the decisions as how they want to handle something if they see some information or an event come from the physical security system. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and turn things over to my colleague, Ray Coulombe. So thanks.
Thank you, Bob. Again, my name is Ray Coulombe from Gilwell Technology Services, and whereas Bob looked at the issue of vulnerability from a top-down approach with an emphasis on access control, I'm going to take the opposite tact and look at things from a bottom-up standpoint with respect to closed-circuit television applications. First of all, in the CCTV market, as we think about the percentage of applications that are converged, that is physical security riding on the larger corporate or enterprise scale network, one industry source says that 17% of applications today are converged. While that number is debatable, what is interesting is that same source over the next 5 years only projects a 9% growth in this number, which in my opinion is surprisingly low. If that is the case, then one has to think that is due in no small part to the chasm that still exists between IT and physical security. And why does that chasm exist? Well, again, I would argue that part of the reason would be due to a concern about network security. What's going to happen when physical security devices that I know nothing about are placed on my corporate network? there is legitimate concern on the security of video. A recent example with a predator drone in the Pakistan area was well publicized by the Wall Street Journal. The bad guys essentially on the ground got the video, and we don't know what they did with it, but one would assume that they went and they hid. Should that video be encrypted? Well, no less an authority than Bruce Schneider weighed on the issue and said that maybe encryption isn't the issue, that key management is likely going to be the issue. If you are not managing your keys and the people who are supposed to get that video can't get it, what good is it in the first place? On another vein, one only has to Google hack CCTV to see the number of tools that exist out there to gain access to any number of unsecured video cameras. In this particular graphic, the video on YouTube was narrated by, I think it was a boy, about 14 years old, whose voice hadn't changed yet, providing very detailed instructions on how to hack video. So there is at least something to the fact that network video may not be fully secure and creates a legitimate concern for the IT person. So we return to the question, do physical security suppliers have products which have essentially ignored the network security implications of their being on the network? In order to test this, we took a sampling of IP camera suppliers, six companies as shown here, who represent about 75% of the IP camera market, and looked at them in some detail. This is a summary of the features that were examined, and it was interesting because the going into assumption to this presentation was that perhaps people who had come from the physical security world were not doing a particularly good job of embedding security features into their products. Surprisingly, the number of features that have been endowed into those products is larger than what was expected. Some of the things that you would expect, like passwords, were certainly there, and there were interesting features in that regard. For example, access communications allows, or actually requires, users to log in securely to set those passwords. Cisco requires complexity checks to make sure that the passwords endowed in their cameras are sufficiently strong. There are a number of other parameters that you can see here on this graphic. To look at a couple in more detail, here is a screen from an access camera for IP address filtering, basically an access control list on the camera. Some of the vendors respect that. So whereas a network should have its own access control list configured on their routers and elsewhere, in this case, we have an extra measure of security as provided by the manufacturer. There's no implicit deny statement in this particular camera, which requires somebody to explicitly configure it, but nevertheless, it's a recognition by that manufacturer of the need to do some address filtering. In another regard, we were quite surprised to see most vendors supporting port-based 802.1x-based security. And even more surprising was the fact that one vendor, the vendor whose feet are most firmly entrenched in the security market with little IT background, had the most extensive set of protocols for authentication over the LAN. So that's the good news, that the camera manufacturers are making good progress towards implementing security features in their products. Sadly, however, that's not the last word, because while the cameras can be thought of as image acquisition devices, we still have to view and store that video. And in physical security and CCTV, that is typically done with third-party video management systems. And that is the other part of the equation. That wasn't examined in detail, but at least in speaking with the IP camera manufacturers, they conceded the fact that if the management systems viewing and managing those systems aren't themselves secure or have not fully integrated with their own camera systems, then some of the features that are endowed in the cameras themselves might well be lost or at least not utilized. Things like passwords, usernames, API calls, a lot of this stuff can be sent in clear text if not properly arranged for. One manufacturer in particular we looked at and spoke to, ONSSI, recommends the use of good network security, i.e. VLANs. In this case, IP cameras unicast to their server, who maintains a database of usernames and passwords, and all the video is dispensed then from their server out to whoever is using that. So whether it's this particular manufacturer or others, we have to look at the security of those applications to see if we really have overall security. And in fact, our systems from camera to the management system on an end-to-end basis truly secure. So back to our premise, or to our question. Do we create new vulnerabilities? Well, it's still a work in progress, but there is progress, and that's the good news. The IP camera manufacturers have made strong progress in their own product development. Sony, for example, is on its fifth generation IP camera with increasing features with each new generation. However, the video management systems create possible issues and really suggest that there needs to be an integrated end-to-end approach from camera through management system in order to guarantee the greatest possible chance of network security in the video system. There are also implementation issues. There's a lot of work that's required on the implementation, meaning that camera manufacturers need to improve their documentation in terms of the information that is exposed, how that information is transmitted and displayed, and how a relatively unenlightened population on the physical security side can grasp these concepts and make sure they're properly implemented in their final system. Also, the number of resources, people resources, that are available at the manufacturer to answer people's basic questions is very limited. Of the manufacturers that I studied, one simply couldn't produce anybody who could intelligently discuss this for purposes of this presentation. As we apply this information then from both the macro, access control, micro, and CCTV standpoints, several points should be made. First of all, take a look at the equipment that's being implemented in the system, the physical security equipment, and the features inherent in that. Two, make sure that your network itself, regardless of the application, is positioned in the best possible way for network security. Employ depth of defense. Take a holistic end-to-end approach. Do those things that one would normally do to respect network security, considering physical security is one of those applications that needs to be supported. Whoever is implementing that physical security network on the network needs to make sure that its integrators and that its implementers do a proper job, that they're properly qualified and do a strong implementation. And finally, if you don't see the features that you think are required, push on your vendors. Require the products that go onto your network to respect network security and force those vendors that may be lagging, that you may have a preference for, to toe the line. With that, our session is concluded. Thank you for your attention. Have a good day.